In Lesson 5, we discuss this subject, how to appropriate the redemptive and covenant blessing of bodily healing. Please note this. In this message, we are repeating a few of the statements made in our previous lesson, in order that this one message shall contain enough to lay a complete foundation for faith. This is done for the benefit of some who may need the prayer of faith for their healing before they have time to listen to the entire series. The first step toward being healed is the same as the first step toward salvation or any other blessing that God promises. The sick person must know what the Bible clearly teaches, that it is God's will to heal until one has lived out the allotted span of life. Each individual sufferer must be convinced by the Word of God that his or her healing is the will of God. It is impossible to have real faith for healing as long as there is the slightest doubt as its being God's will. It is impossible to boldly claim by faith a blessing which we are not certain that God offers, because the power of God can be claimed only where the will of God is known. For instance, it would be next to impossible to get a sinner to believe unto righteousness before you had fully convinced him that it was God's will to save him. Faith begins where the will of God is known. Faith must rest on the will of God alone, not on our desires or wishes. Appropriating faith is not believing that God can, but that He will. Those who claim to believe in healing, but say one word in favor of it and 10 words against it, cannot produce faith for healing. When God commands us to pray for the sick, He means us to pray with faith. We could not do this if we did not know His will in the matter. Until a person knows God's will, they have no basis for faith, because faith is expecting God to do what we know it is His will to do. It is not hard, when we have faith, to get God to do His own will. When we know it is His will, it is not difficult for us to believe that He will do what we are sure He wants to do. It is in this way that every saved person has experienced the still greater miracle of the new birth. There can be no appropriation by faith until we are made to know by the gospel what God has provided for us. There is no doctrine more emphatically taught throughout the Word of God than that through the atonement of Christ both salvation and bodily healing were provided. It is God's will to take away sickness of His own people, and to fulfill the number of their days according to His promise, in Exodus 23, verses 25 and 26. As the types in Leviticus 14 and 15 show that it was invariably through the atonement that sickness was healed under the law of Moses, so Matthew 8:17 definitely states that Jesus healed all diseases on the ground of atonement. This scripture shows us that Christ's reason for making no exceptions while healing the sick who thronged Him was His atonement, which He made for all of Adam's race, including you. As multitude after multitude pressed upon Him to hear Him and to be healed of their diseases, it is repeatedly stated throughout the Gospels, He healed them all. This can be seen through the following references: Matthew 4, verse 24, chapter 12, verse 15, chapter 14, verse 14, Luke, chapter 4, verse 40, Acts, chapter 10, verse 38. He could make no exceptions. Why? Because in His coming atonement, He Himself took our infirmities. Since it is our infirmities He bore, it requires the healing of all to fulfill this prophecy. God carefully put this in such language that we would have to misquote it to leave ourselves out. God's way of saving the soul, of healing the body, and of doing everything else He wants to do, is to send His word, His promise, and then keep the promise wherever it produces faith. The divine procedure in healing is stated in the text, He sendeth His word and healeth them, and delivereth them from their graves, Psalm 107, verse 20. It is the word of God which effectually worketh in them that believeth, and is health to all their flesh. Take a look at 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 12. Also at Proverbs chapter 4, verse 22. Just as a little girl's faith for a new dress comes by hearing the promise of her mother to buy it next Saturday, so faith for healing comes by hearing God's word or promise to do it. Both the little girl's faith and ours cometh by hearing. Now, the little girl could not and would not be expected to have faith for the new dress until her mother promised it. So we cannot, nor are we expected to have faith for healing or salvation or any other blessing until the faith comes by hearing the word or the promise of what God wants to do. How could anyone find justification by faith until it was preached unto him? And how could anyone find healing by faith until it was preached to him? It is the Scriptures which are able to make men wise unto salvation. We must see that the Creator and Redeemer of the body is also its physician, before we have reason to expect healing. Now, since He heals us by sending His Word, what can be more His Word than His redemptive and covenant names, which were given, all seven of them, for the specific purpose of revealing to every man in Adam's race his redemptive attitude toward them? When Christ commands us to preach the gospel to every creature, He means that we shall tell the good news of redemption. His seven redemptive names reveal what our redemption includes. He has many other names, but only seven redemptive names. And these seven names are never used in the Scripture except in His dealings with man. Not six, not eight, but seven, the perfect number, because He's a perfect Savior, His redemption covering the whole scope of human need. The blessings revealed by each of these names are all in the atonement. For instance, Jehovah Shammah means the Lord is present, made nigh by the blood of His cross. Jehovah Shalom is translated, the Lord is our peace. This is in the atonement because the chastisement of our peace was upon Him. Jehovah Rea is translated, the Lord is my shepherd. He became our shepherd by giving His life for the sheep. So you see, this privilege is in the atonement. Jehovah Jireh means the Lord will provide an offering, Christ Himself being the offering provided on Calvary. He became Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our banner or victor, by spoiling principalities and powers on the cross. He bore our sins and became Jehovah Tzidkenu, the Lord our righteousness, opening the way for every sinner to receive the gift of righteousness. Jehovah Rapha is translated, I am the Lord that healeth thee, or I am the Lord thy physician. This also is in the atonement, for Himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. This completes the list of seven names which were given for the purpose of revealing God's relationship toward us, all under each of these seven titles. These seven names all belong abidingly to Christ. It is under each of these seven titles that He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus says to all who come to Him for any of these seven blessings, He that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. This is the good news that God once preached to every creature, so that every creature may have the privilege of enjoying the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ. I say again that nothing is more God's word settled in heaven than His redemptive name Jehovah Rapha. No one has a right to change God's I am Jehovah Rapha to I was, because the word of the Lord endureth forever. Since Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace, is one of Christ's redemptive names, has not every man a redemption right to obtain peace from Him? Has not every man a redemptive right to obtain victory from Jehovah Nissi? Has not every man a redemptive right to obtain the gift of righteousness from Jehovah Tzidkenu? If so, why has not every man a redemptive right to obtain healing from Jehovah Rapha? This name Jehovah Rapha was so accepted and believed by those to whom it was first sent that there was not one feeble person among all their tribes. Whenever this state of health was interfered with by their transgressions, as soon as they repented, typical atonements were made, and God was still Jehovah Rapha, the healer, not to some, but to all. God wants this name, as well as all others, to be sent to every creature, with the promise, they shall recover, for the Lord shall raise them up. The brazen serpent was a type of Christ. God ratified this word to the dying Israelites by sending them the added word, every one that is bitten when he looketh upon it, the type of Calvary, shall live. If bodily healing is not provided in the atonement, why were these dying Israelites required to look at the type of the atonement for bodily healing? As their curse was removed by the lifting up of the type of Christ, so ours is removed by the lifting up of Christ, the antitype. Since the Spirit is given to us to make Christ real, why should we not look to Christ Himself with as much expectation as they did to the type? It will be well to note that they could not look at the brass snake and their symptoms at the same time. Abraham's faith waxed strong while he looked unto the promise of God. Some people reverse this, and their faith waxes weak while they look at their symptoms, forgetting the promise. Since God healed by sending His word, which is the only basis for our faith, we will miss healing if we allow our symptoms to hinder us from expecting what His word promises. The second step is to be sure that you're right with God, because our redemptive blessings are conditional. After we hear the gospel and know what it offers, Jesus says, "Repent and believe the gospel." Only those who are right with God can follow these instructions. When seeking healing for our bodies, there should be no compromise with the adversary of our souls. It is he who is the author of our diseases. Jesus has not promised to destroy the works of the devil in our bodies while we're clinging to the work of the devil in our souls. It is hard to exercise faith for the removal of one part of the devil's work while we allow a worse part to remain. Until a man squarely faces and settles the question of obedience to God, he is not on believing ground. James says, "Confess your faults one to another, that ye may be healed." It is God's will that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. It is when our hearts do not condemn us that we have confidence toward God. The command for the sick to send for the elders was first written to Christians who had been filled with the Spirit. There's something wrong when a man desires the blessing but not the blesser, his mercy but not himself. It is not proper to seek his mercy while rejecting his will. Do not ask for a little blessing while rejecting the big one. It is impossible to receive and reject divine blessings at the same time. God is waiting to say to Satan and disease what he said to Pharaoh, "Let my people go, that they may serve me." Our first consideration in all things, even in asking for the restoration of bodily health, should be the glory of God. Strength for service to God is the only proper basis to approach when seeking healing at His hand. The anointing with oil for healing is itself a symbol and a sign of consecration. We must desire our health for God's glory. What then does the anointing mean? Turn to Leviticus chapter 8, verses 10 to 12, and you get God's answer to the question. "And Moses took the anointing oil and anointed the tabernacle and all that was therein, and sanctified them." That is, he set them apart for God. The anointing with oil in the name of the Lord was an act of dedication and consecration, implying on the part of one anointed a full surrender to God of his hands to work for him and for him alone, of his feet to walk for him and him alone, his eyes to see, his lips to speak, his ears to hear for him and him alone, and his whole body to be the temple of the Holy Spirit. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. 3 John, verse 2. The Holy Spirit tells us to submit ourselves to God before He says, "Resist the devil." No one can successfully resist the devil until he submits himself to God. When the devil is thus resisted, he will not merely walk away, he will literally run or flee from you. James chapter 4, verse 7. The curse, including the different diseases cataloged in Deuteronomy in the 28th chapter, came upon the people because their obedience and their service was not with gladness and joyfulness of heart. The condition of heart that was responsible for the coming of those diseases mentioned in that chapter was not acceptable to God. Psalm 37 verse 4 says, It is those who will delight themselves in the Lord to whom He gives the desires of their heart. God has not lowered the standard for this day of grace. It is only to the obedient, those who will diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord and do that which is right in His sight, that it is said, "The Lord will take away from thee all sickness." Take a look at Deuteronomy 7, verse 15, also Exodus 15, verse 26. Faith, you see, is the union of our hearts and wills with God's will and purpose. And where this unity is lacking, results are impossible. This is a very important spiritual law, to which in our times we have been woefully blind. God says, of fearing the Lord and departing from evil, it shall itself be health, the Hebrew means medicine, to thy navel, and marrow, the Hebrew here means moistening, to thy bones. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 7 and 8. Faith always implies obedience. Paul wrote to the Ephesians to obey the first commandment, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth, Ephesians 6, 3. Naaman's surrender and obedience to the word of God was complete before he was healed. It is to those who walk uprightly that it is said, no good thing will he withhold, Psalm 84, verse 11. Therefore, before seeking anything from God, we should yield ourselves to the first and great commandment, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. God says in Psalm 91, verse 4, because he hath set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. Deuteronomy 7, 9 says, he keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him, and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. Therefore, like the leper, let us come and worship him when asking for healing. Length of days is in her, that is, wisdom's right hand, and her left hand, riches and honor, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 16. Marry wisdom, and you get her possessions. Wisdom is here represented as a bountiful queen, holding forth blessings with both hands to all who will become subject to her government. It is for them whose heart is perfect toward him that the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong. See 2 Chronicles 16, verse 30. Proverbs 14, verse 30 says, a sound heart is the life of the flesh, but envy the rottenness of the bones. An unsound heart is worse than an unsound stomach. A diseased soul is worse than a diseased body. A disordered will is worse than a disordered liver. Paul said, the body for the Lord, before he said, the Lord for the body. The Bible teaches that the body is bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. 1 Corinthians 6:20. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, which is your reasonable service. Romans 12, verse 1. Therefore, present your body to him if you want to be healed. It is not until after it becomes his property that he promises to repair it. Bryant said, the sure way for the sick is first the cross for cleansing, then to the upper room for the gift of the Spirit, then to the mount appointed for a life commission, and lastly, to the great physician for strength for service. If the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Romans 8, verse 11. In Christ, the true vine, there is all the life for our souls and bodies that we need. But how are we to possess and enjoy this except by our union with the vine? It is not apart from him, but in him that ye are complete, according to Colossians 2, verse 10. Substitution without union is not sufficient for our possession and enjoyment of the life of the vine. If you need a miracle, get in tune with the miracle worker. We enjoy the life of the vine by our perfect union with the vine. Asking for healing while refusing to be led by the Spirit is like asking a carpenter to repair the house while refusing to let him in the house. Matthew 14, verse 36 says, As many as touched him were made perfectly whole. You cannot touch him with a reservation. Like the woman who pressed through the throng and touched him, you must elbow your way and press beyond selfishness, disobedience, unconfessed sins, lukewarmness, public opinion, traditions of men and articles written against divine healing. Sometimes you must press beyond your own pastor, who may be unenlightened in this particular part of the gospel. Press beyond doubts, double-mindedness, symptoms, feelings, and the lying serpent. The Holy Spirit, who is sent to execute for us the blessings of redemption, is our paraclete or helper, and is ready to help us press through and beyond all of these obstacles to the place where we can touch him for our needs. God is waiting to pour out the Holy Spirit in fullness upon us. He comes as Christ's executive to execute for us all the blessings provided by Calvary and pledged to us in his seven redemptive and covenant names. It is still true that as many as touch him are made whole. How do we touch him? By believing his promise. This is an infallible way of touching Christ for anything he has promised. We touch him by asking and believing that he hears our prayers when we pray. When the woman touched him, it was her faith that made her whole, not a mere physical touch. The flesh profiteth nothing, the Spirit giveth life. Millions of sinners have in this way touched him for the yet greater miracle of the new birth. As the sick touched him and were made whole when Christ walked upon the earth, so now it is the privilege of all to actually touch him. The touch now unites us to Christ in a closer union than it did then. Not mere contact, but union, as real as the branch and the vine. All that is in the vine, including both spiritual and physical life, belongs to us, the branches. The touch by faith can now bring us under the full control of the Holy Spirit, who is the miracle worker, as it could not do during Christ's earthly ministry, for the Spirit was not yet given. Jesus is not less a Savior and healer since being glorified, he's greater. The privilege of touching him now is much greater than it was when he was here in person, because more can now be received by the touch. From God's right hand, he has more to give. He said, "It is expedient or profitable for you that I go away." Since the Spirit comes to reveal Christ, as he could not be revealed before he went away, to send the Spirit, why cannot we approach him for healing with at least as much faith as those who thronged him in that day? These concepts show the great importance of being right with God before asking for healing. The blessing of being right with God is 1,000 times more desirable and enjoyable than the healing itself. I have seen the afflicted in body radiantly happy, but sinners in perfect health have been so unhappy as to commit suicide. We will now endeavor to make plain the third step in how to appropriate healing. Getting things from God is like playing checkers. After one person moves, he has nothing to do until the other player moves. Each man moves in his own turn. So when God has provided healing or any other blessing and sent us his word, it is our move before he will move again. Our move is to expect what he promises when we pray, which will cause us to act our faith before we see the healing. The healing comes in the next move, which is God's move. God never moves out of his turn, but he always moves when it is his turn. When Noah was warned of God of things not seen as yet, his move was to believe that the flood was coming and act his faith by building the ship on dry land. So when God says to the sick, "The prayer of faith shall save the sick and the Lord shall raise him up," you, like Noah, are informed of God of things not seen as yet. Your move is the same as Noah's, which is to believe and act accordingly. Fallen nature is governed by what it sees, by its senses, but faith is governed by the pure word of God. It is nothing less than expecting God to do what he promises, treating him like an honest being. By expectation, I do not mean hope. One writer has well said, "We hope for what may be possible, but we expect what must be possible." With that expectancy that shuts out doubt or fear of failure, and shows unshakable confidence. Faith never waits to see before it believes, because it cometh by hearing about things not seen as yet, and is the evidence of things not seen. All that a man of faith needs is to know that God has spoken. This imparts perfect certainty to the soul. Thus saith the Lord, settles everything. It is written, is all that faith needs. Faith always blows the ram's horn before, not after, the walls are down. Faith never judges according to the sight of the eyes, because it is the evidence of things not seen but promised. Faith rests on far more solid ground than the evidence of the senses, and that is the Word of God, which abideth forever. Our senses may deceive us, but God's Word, never. When the little girl is promised a new dress next Saturday, faith is the actual expectation which she has and manifests between now and Saturday. When Saturday comes and she sees the new dress, faith for the new dress stops. Now, real faith always has corresponding actions. The little girl, because of her faith, claps her hands and says, "Goody, goody, I'm going to have a new dress next Saturday," and runs to tell her playmates that she has the answer to her request. God cannot lie. Jesus at the grave of Lazarus looked up and said, "I thank thee, Father, that thou hast heard me," though Lazarus was still dead. The little girl is not afraid to testify in advance that she is to have a new dress. When her playmates say, "How do you know you are?" she confidently replies, "Why, Mama promised it." Now you have a better reason for expecting healing than the little girl has, for expecting a new dress, because the mother may die before Saturday, but God cannot. The mother can lie, but God cannot. The house may burn down with the mother's money. Every case of faith in history has a well-grounded assurance produced by the promise of God alone, and acted on before there was anything visible to encourage the assurance, as with the little girl between now and Saturday. Faith looks not at the things that are seen. There was no flood in sight when Noah built his ark. Stone walls had never before fallen down at the blowing of the ram's horn in shouting. They were merely expecting what God promised, and when they acted their faith by blowing the ram's horn while the walls were still up, this was their move. Then, of course, God moved in his turn, and down came the walls. The whole 11th chapter of Hebrews is written to show how each one who had faith acted between now and Saturday. God is so well pleased with the actings of faith that he has listed in detail many cases as recorded in the 11th chapter of Hebrews. By faith, Noah acted so-and-so. By faith, Jacob acted so-and-so. By faith, Joseph acted, and so on. By faith, Moses acted, and so on. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down. By faith, Abraham acted so-and-so, and when everything seemed contrary to what God had promised, it was by considering the promise of God, not her barrenness, that Sarah received strength to become a mother when she was past age. These all acted with nothing but the Word of God as their reason for expecting the thing he had promised. It's the same with every case of faith in history. Jonah's symptoms were very real when he was inside the fish, and he did not deny them, but he called them lying vanities. In other words, any symptoms that make us doubt the fact that God is plenteous in mercy to all that call upon him should be regarded as lying vanities. Jonah said, "They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy." Instead of listening to Satan and watching our symptoms, we must be workers together with God, who heals by sending his word and keeping it. We must cooperate with him by being occupied, not with what the devil says, but with the word he sends for our healing. Even when we do act our faith, symptoms do not always disappear instantly. After Hezekiah was healed, it was 3 days before he was strong enough to go up to the house of the Lord. In John 4, verses 50 to 52, the nobleman believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and when he met his servants, he inquired of them the hour when his dying son began to amend. The Bible differentiates between the gifts of healing and the gifts of miracles. Christ could do no miracle in Nazareth because of their unbelief, but he healed a few sick ones. If everyone were to be made perfectly whole instantly, there would be no place for the gifts of healing. It would all be miracles. Many people miss healing by trying to confine God to performing a miracle. Christ's promise is that they shall recover, but he does not say instantly. The symptoms of life in a tree remain for a time even after the tree is cut down. Faith means we are confident of what we hope for, convinced of what we do not see. Hebrews 11, verse 1, Moffat's translation. Convinced, of course, because God, who cannot lie, has spoken. How all-sufficient is this reason for believing? Faith is, therefore, most rational. It is not, as many unthinking persons suppose, believing without evidence, but believing because of the very highest possible evidence, God's Word, which is settled in heaven. The Apostle James says, "I will show you by my action what faith is." Again, Moffat's translation. Faith, therefore, is being so convinced of the absolute truth of the declarations of God which are recorded in the Bible that we act on them. Faith is both rational and safe. What can be more rational, and what can be more safe and certain? Faith is to receive the written promise of God as his direct message to us. His promise means the same as if he appeared and said to us, "I've heard your prayer." The Word of God has made life to our bodies in exactly the same way that it has made life to our souls, which is by believing his promise. Some have prayed for healing for as long as 40 years without receiving it, and then, as soon as they were told how to appropriate, the healing has come sometimes in a moment. We do not have to pray for 40 years or for 1 week for the blessing that Christ is eager to bestow. His compassionate heart yearns to heal us more than we have the capacity to desire it. We keep him waiting until we have the faith that cometh by hearing, and act that faith. God will not cheat and move out of his turn. After seeing that Jesus bore our diseases as well as our sins on the cross, and therefore that we need not bear them, our next step is to appropriate by faith, which is the only scriptural way. The truth of the matter is, God gave us this part of our inheritance nearly 2,000 years ago, and he is the waiting one. He is waiting for us to appropriate the blessing by faith. 2,000 years ago, God put away sin. 2,000 years ago, God laid on Christ the iniquity of us all. 2,000 years ago, he took on himself our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. God is the waiting party, waiting for us to be shown how to appropriate the blessing he has already given. 2 Peter 3:9 says, "The Lord is not slack or slow concerning his promises, but he is long-suffering to usward." Or, as Weymouth translates, "The Lord is not slow in fulfilling his promises, but he bears patiently with you." In other words, he's not slow concerning his promises, but we are slow, and he is patient with us. Most of us could have been saved 5 years earlier than we were. God was not making us wait, but we were making him wait. It's the same way with our healing. Now in Mark 11:24, Jesus tells us exactly how to appropriate any of the blessings purchased for us by his death. Having promised all that we need, he says, "What things soever you desire when ye pray," notice, not after you pray 20 years, but not after you get well, "but while you are sick, when ye pray, believe ye receive them, and ye shall have them." The condition of receiving what we ask God for is to believe that he answers our prayers when we pray, that we shall recover according to his promise. In other words, when you pray for healing, Christ authorizes you to consider your prayer answered, as when he stood at the grave of Lazarus and said, "I thank thee, Father, that thou hast heard me," before he saw Lazarus come forth from the grave. When we ask for healing, Christ bids us to say, with faith, "I thank thee, Father, that thou hast heard me," before we have seen the answer to our prayer. God's word alone is our reason for believing that our prayer is answered, before we see or feel. This is faith. Jesus declared, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." John says, "The word is God." To receive the written words of Christ as the direct message to us is faith. This is the way the Word of God becomes life to us, both in our healing and in our salvation. For instance, the act of believing and receiving Christ according to John 1:12 is synonymous with the act of God which gives us, by His power, the new birth. By this same process also is divine healing imparted to our bodies. Another has said that with the woman who touched his garment, faith, fact, feeling is the order of healing that God never departs from. If we depart from this order, neither faith or fact nor feeling will be as we desire, because they will not be as God desires. 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 13 says, "It is the word of God which effectually worketh also in you that believe." When His word convinces us that our prayer is answered, before we have yet seen the answer, the word begins to effectually work in us. God's word never fails to work in those who accept it as such, because they are not entertaining doubts as to its being fulfilled in their own experiences. God has given all His blessings to faith, and has none left to bestow upon unbelief. When people say to me, "I do not know that it is God's will to heal me," I ask them, "Is it God's will to keep His promise?" If we are right with God, we should not consider ourselves any more than we would when men make promises to us. Not have I faith enough, but is He honest? It's not a question of how we feel, but what are the facts? Should the little girl get sick the next day and feel badly, it has nothing to do with her mother buying her a new dress on Saturday. The Scriptures say, "If we ask anything according to His will, He heareth us." Is this true or is it not? Does God answer prayer? If you will steadfastly believe that you receive the answer to your prayer and act your faith, every one of you will be healed, though not always instantly. God always moves after our move. This is the acting out of a full assurance, produced alone by His promise before we see the answer to our prayer. Since healing is by faith and faith without works is dead, it is when we begin to act our faith that God begins to heal. Our faith makes God act. Our work of faith sets God to working. No, we cannot all act in the same way. As the 10 lepers went, they were healed. Jonah, when inside the fish, could not go anywhere, but he did act his faith by saying, while still in the fish, "I will sacrifice with the voice of thanksgiving." And so acting our faith by praising and thanking God in advance has been throughout history His appointed way for our appropriation of all His blessings. Hebrews 13:15 teaches us that our thank offering, our sacrifice of praise, is to be offered in advance for the blessing God has promised. Psalms 50, verse 14 and 15 says, "Offer unto God thanksgiving, and pay thy vows unto the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me." Here, as elsewhere, we are required to offer thanksgiving while we are still in trouble, as Jonah did. Perhaps this was the very promise he claimed. "Let the needy praise thy name," that is, praise God in advance while you're still in need. "Let us come before His presence with thanksgiving" does not mean to get healed and then go from His presence thanking Him. We should come to Him with thanksgiving for healing before being healed. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. We should also go away with thanksgiving, but this is not faith. Faith is what we have done before we are healed. "They shall praise the Lord that seek Him. Thou shalt call thy walls salvation and thy gates praise." Without praise, we are up against a solid wall with no gate. But when we begin praising and appropriating, we hang our own gate and walk through. "Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things." They were continually in the temple praising and blessing God, not after, but before they were filled with the Holy Spirit. It was when they lifted up their voice and praised the Lord that the glory of the Lord filled the house of God. They believed His words, not their symptoms, not the father of lies, and sang His praises. Make Satan listen to your praises. Instead of your listening to the father of lies, make him listen to your praising God for His promise. "Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord." The sick man has breath. In other words, while you're still sick, praise Him because you're going to recover according to His promise. "Let not your heart be troubled. In nothing be anxious or distracted, but with thanksgiving let your requests be made known unto God. casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Every sick Christian, while sick, has 1,000 times more to be happy over than the most cheerful sinner in perfect health. Praise God, because faith without works is dead. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you. I will praise the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Since everything that hath breath is commanded to praise the Lord, the only scriptural excuse for not praising him is to be out of breath. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually, the fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. Whoso offereth praise glorifieth me. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Praise him, because it is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord. Give thanks at the remembrance of his holiness. Praise him, because to withhold praise will show either unbelief or ingratitude. Praise him, because praise is comely for the upright. Praise him, because God inhabits the praises of his people. Paul and Silas sang praises at midnight, with their backs bleeding and their feet in the stocks, and God sang bass with an earthquake, which set them free. Real faith rejoices in the promises of God, as if it saw the deliverance and was enjoying it. With 3 great armies against Jehoshaphat, which, humanly speaking, would mean annihilation, they praised the Lord with a loud voice on high. The only evidence that their prayer was answered was the naked word of God, and that only through human lips. The next day, when they went out to the battle and began to sing the praise, the Lord, in his turn, moved and set ambushments against the enemy, and the victory was won, 2 Chronicles 20, verses 18 and 19. We have also a more sure word of prophecy. For holy men of old spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 19 to 21. As in Eden, the enemy succeeded in making void God's testimony as to the results of eating the forbidden fruit. So now he seeks to make void God's testimony as to the results of believing the gospel. After God said, "In the day thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die," the serpent said, "Thou shalt not surely die." Now when God's word plainly says, "They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover," the same serpent seeks to persuade them that they shall not recover. Is it rational to believe the father of lies in preference to the Son of God, who is incarnate truth? When coming to God for salvation or healing, it is essential for each one to decide whether he shall allow the hiss of the serpent to rise above the voice of God. Thomas A. Kempis said, "Blessed are the ears that hear the pulses of the divine whisper, and give no heed to the many whisperings of the world." When after you have been anointed for healing, Satan tells you that you will not recover, like Jesus, say to him, "It is written, they shall recover. The Lord shall raise him up." James 5, verse 14. Also in the same passage, "In the name of the Lord" means the same as if the Lord himself anointed you. Expect him to honor his own ordinance and his own promise. Why listen to the devil? All the devil heard from the lips of Christ when tempting him was, "It is written, it is written, it is written." Then the devil leaveth him. But all we hear from some people is, the devil says," as though God's words were of less consequence than those of the devil. This was Christ's way, and it is the most successful way of resisting the devil. Let us not try another way. "Neither give place to the devil," Ephesians 4:27. "Resist the devil and he'll flee from you," James 4:7. There's just one way of resisting the devil, and that is by steadfastly believing and acting upon God's word. Whenever we are affected by another voice more than the voice of God, we have forsaken the Lord's way for our healing. What reason have you for doubting? You have no more reason for doubting than the sinner has when he repents and asks forgiveness for his sins. You have exactly the same reason for expecting to be healed that you had for expecting to be saved. You have his word for it, and if you cannot accept that to the point of acting upon it, then your faith is still very far from what it should be. The Lord's compassion is our greatest basis for faith. Since Christ has redeemed us from sickness, surely his love and faithfulness may be trusted? The cross is like a sure foundation and a perfect reason for the exercise of faith. Let us put our sickness away by faith, as we would put away sin. The consecrated Christian will not consciously tolerate sin for a moment. And yet how tolerant some are toward sickness. They'll even pet and indulge their aches and pains, instead of resisting them as the works of the devil. The Lord Jesus has declared concerning the sin, sorrow, and physical misery of Adam's race, "It is finished," and has offered unto each one of us the gift of the Holy Spirit to enable us to realize and fully enjoy the great salvation he purchased for us. To believe without doubt that Christ's words, "It is finished," is a literal statement of an unchangeable fact, invariably brings deliverance. The serpent is still denying this great saying of Christ to our great loss, just as he caused Eve to forget and disregard words which God had plainly spoken to her. It is by realizing that our redemption from sickness was actually accomplished in the body of our crucified Lord, and by wholeheartedly believing and receiving what God declares in his written word about this matter, that the Holy Spirit gives us the personal experience of Christ, our physician. Following these instructions has brought soundness upon thousands who had before been taught that the age of miracles was past, and that God wanted people to remain sick for his glory. Those born blind are now seeing. Deaf and dumb mutes from birth are now hearing and speaking. Cripples from birth are now perfectly whole. Epileptics for years are now free and rejoicing. Many who were dying with cancers are now well and praying the prayer of faith for the healing of others. And God is no respecter of persons. God's new covenant provides that each shall be made perfect in every good work to do his will. This cannot be while we are sick. This shows his willingness to make us well, in fact, his eagerness. He cannot keep his covenant with us without taking away our sicknesses and fulfilling the number of our days according to his promise. Since it is by his stripes we are healed, let us not forget what our healing cost. With gratitude and love and consecrated service to God, let us stand on his promise and blow the ram's horn of faith and thanksgiving until the walls of our affliction fall down flat. Faith does not wait for the walls to fall down. Faith shouts them down.